Cellular Automata are a deceptively simple tool that you can use to make your games more interesting and dynamic. Simply defined, they can be thought of as a group of things that change over time based upon what is next to them. And they can be used for all sorts of things. They can be used for outbreak simulations, fluid simulations, and of course, what we're going to cover today, procedural generation. Hello everyone, my name is Sam Spate, and this tutorial is inspired by a recent written tutorial by Refresher Tal. You can follow his written tutorial here and get all of his code as well. I really love Cellular Automata, so when I read his tutorial, I immediately wanted to make my own, and he graciously gave me permission to make this YouTube tutorial based off of his written one. So if anything I say doesn't make sense, or I go over something too fast, you've got his article, and even better, his tutorial, as you can see, is part of a series. So there's a lot of other cool things to check out as well. Also, remember to check out his game, Spacelingers, made in GameMaker Studio and recently released on Steam. But with that, let's make the definition a group of things that change over time based upon what is next to them a little more specific. First, what is that group of things? Traditionally, it is a grid of cells. It can be one-dimensional, two-dimensional, or three-dimensional. Second, each of these cells have a state, a way that they are at any given time. These states can be simple, such as on or off, or complex, such as a collection of data or a range of numbers. Third, that state needs to change over time. So a very important idea with cellular automata is that of generations. There are different ways it can be done, but most classically, all cells are updated at the same time. Finally, this change, this progression of generations, is governed by the state of each cell's neighbors. So each cell looks at its neighbors and then follows a set of rules based upon the condition or state of its neighbors for how to change itself. But let's see one of the most famous examples of this, James Conway's The Game of Life. Here we have a grid of cells, and each cell has a state, on or off. In this case, you can see that the off states are gray and the on states are yellow. And each cell, as you can see, is changing its state over time. This is the number of generations down here. We're not going to go over the rules in any detail, but you can see them here. And most importantly, you can see that they're not very complex. They're actually very, very simple. And even though these are incredibly simple rules, you can get really interesting, dynamic, and complex results. So what are the steps that we need to do to make something like this ourselves? First, we'll need to create a grid, then create an initial generation, you know, some data in that grid, and then we need to iterate through generations, where in each generation, the individual cells update their state based on their neighbors and the rules that we supply. And that's really it. Create a grid, create an initial generation, and then iterate through those generations based on rules. So let's switch over to GameMaker. Before we jump into the code, let me go over the project setup. We've got a room, which I haven't made any real modifications to. Its size is 600 by 600. In this room, I've put the object that will control our cellular automata, which I think in the singular form is actually cellular automaton, but I'm going to keep referring to it as a cellular automata, or CA. And we have our collection of scripts. These two things right here, the scripts and this object, are the only thing with code. And we're going to go over them in detail in just a moment. But lastly, I just want to point out that I've created a square object. It has no code, and it just has this square sprite, which is a white square that is 10 by 10. And this is what I'm going to use to display the data in our map to the screen. But with that, let's jump into code. We're going to start with our cellular automata scripts. And now, while a lot of this code is going to be very similar to Refresher Tal's, one change I have made is I'm going to do this with a struct. So you can see that our CA map here is a constructor function indicated by the word constructor over here. And the first thing we're going to do in it is create some variables. We're going to have the width and height of our map, and then we're going to have the create limit and the destroy limit. These will be part of the rules for how we change as we iterate through generations, and we'll come back to them. So now if you remember our action plan, the first thing we need to do is create our grid. Well, I guess because it's code, the first thing we did was initialize our variables, but now we need to create our grid. We can create our grid with a double for loop. I've chosen to iterate over it backwards. To iterate through an array backwards, you start at its width minus one, and you go to greater than or equal to zero, remembering to decrement rather than increment. And this is unnecessary, but it's a little bit faster. The reason for that is if we start with zero and work our way up, the grid is going to get resized each iteration. Whereas here, since we're starting at the max size, it will immediately be set to the correct size. And then as we loop backward, we'll just be changing data. We'll not be continually resizing our grid. I also think it's kind of fun to learn new ways to iterate through arrays. But for something like this, you could also iterate the normal way, going from zero to less than length. If you're unfamiliar, by the way, with how loops work, check out my tutorials on them with the link to the top right, or honestly, a far more detailed written tutorial on them by another GMC member, FrostyCat, and there's a link below for that. But back to the code, as we iterate over our map, we're going to set cells to true at random, just using the built-in random function and checking to see whether or not the value given by this function is less than the spawn chance. So worth mentioning that spawn chance needs to be a number less than one. That spawn chance needs to be a number between 0 and 1. And this actually takes care of the first two things we need to do. We've created our grid and our initial generation. Now, all we really need to do is go over the iteration function. There are different ways to do this, but I've chosen to set it up so that you can use a number, so you can pass in a number, and then iterate that many times. So if you pass in 1, it will only do one iteration, but you could also pass in 10 or 100, and it would just auto-iterate through all of those generations. And that's what repeat is doing here. Inside of our iteration loop, we basically have three steps. The first step is we need to create a new map to hold the new generation. We're going to be changing the state of cells, and if we do that in our current map, then that will mess up future calculations, right? If we change cell 00 and then go on to evaluate 01, its neighbor 00 would be different. We want each new generation to be based upon the existing generation. So we have to keep the new generation data entirely separate while we're doing the update. And the easiest way to do this is just with a separate array. The second step is we actually have to loop through the old map and use the data in the old map to populate the new map with the next generation. Obviously, this is the most complicated part. And then finally, we just have to replace the old map with the new map. Now, while creating the new map is the most complicated part, it really isn't that bad. First, of course, we need to do our double for loop to iterate through the entire grid. And then for each cell, we need to count all of its neighbors. And once we get a count of its neighbors, we can then use our rules to find out how we want to change that cell in the next generation. Getting a count of all the neighbors is pretty straightforward, but it's also a little bit technical because we have to account for a number of edge cases. To do this, we're going to take the current column and row and then do another double for loop around that current column and row to create an offset to check each of its neighbors. This can be difficult to understand without some sort of diagram, so let me switch over to draw.io. So let's say that we have our grid of cells. We are currently looping through it, and we're on this cell right here. We can check for all of its neighbors by doing that second double for loop, where we start from -1 and go to 1 in both directions, and add that value to the current column or row. This neighbor right here is the value of this column and row, -1. -1 for the column, -1 for the row. This is the same column, -1 for the row, +1 for the column, -1 for the row, and that will give us all of the neighbors. And that's what we're doing right here. We have our double for loop starting at -1, stopping at +1, and then we're adding those offsets to our current column and row to get the column and row of the neighbor. But now we have another issue. What if our column and row is on the edge? In that case, you can see that many of the neighbors are going to be outside of the bounds of the grid. This will also mean that if we pass those numbers into an array, we're going to get a game crashing error because we'll be checking outside the bounds of the array. So we need to have a check to see if the numbers that we have are inside the bounds of the array. And we can do that right here by making sure that they are not less than 0 or greater than or equal to the width or height. And then we have another question. If they are outside of the bounds, how should they be counted? I'm going to default to counting them as filled in. So you can just sort of imagine a row of filled in cells outside of our actual grid, but you could also default them to 0, or you could actually just do the internal iteration starting at 1 and ending at width -1 so that you never actually check the outside edges of the grid. And then you could simply keep those edges random, or you could fill them all in or keep them all empty. But I'm going to do it this way with the check and just count them as not empty. We have one last issue here as well, which is what if there is no difference in the column and row? We're at 0, 0. Well, in that case, the cell would be checking itself, and we don't want that. So if we're at 0, 0, we just want to skip over that iteration. And after all of these edge cases have been taken care of, we finally get to do what we want to do, which is check whether or not the neighbor itself is marked as true. And if so, we're going to increase the count by 1. So just to recap, because this is probably the most complicated part of the algorithm, we are looping through all of the cells. And then for each cell, we are looping through all of that cell's neighbors by creating a second double for loop going from -1 to +1 and adding these values to the current column and row, and then checking to make sure that we're not out of bounds and checking to make sure that the cell isn't counting itself. And in the final case, checking the value of the neighbor and adding to the count if it is marked as true. And after we get the count, it's pretty straightforward. We just apply our rules. If the cell is already on, Then, if the count is greater than the destroy limit, it will stay on. If it is less than the destroy limit, that is, if there is a lot of empty space around it, it will also be turned off. And if the cell is off, if there are many cells around it that are on, it will get turned on. If there aren't enough neighbors that are turned on, it will stay off. And that's really it. But now that we've got this down, let's actually make our cellular automata map. We can come over here to the create event of our map maker object. We'll call randomize so we don't get the same results each time we start the game. Note that we only need to call randomize once to get a completely random seed. And then we just create our new map using the keyword new, of course, because it's a constructor function, and passing in the parameters that we want. So we have our width, our height, our spawn chance. So there's a 40% chance at the start that any given cell will be turned on, and then our create limit and our destroy limit. Then all we need to do is iterate through a couple generations. Now that's actually all we need to run this, but to display it, I have one additional thing. I have our function spawn squares here. This function destroys any squares that might already exist, and you'll see why in a moment. And then otherwise, it simply loops through the map, and if that cell in the map is turned on, creates a square at that position, times the spacing, of course, so that they won't overlap. There are, of course, many ways you could draw this map to the screen, or maybe you don't even want to draw, maybe you just want to use its data for something. But using the built-in draw features of GameMaker was pretty easy, and for this tutorial, I stuck with that, just so that there is less for me to explain. Also, if I push R, the game will restart, regenerating all of that code in the create event and giving us a new map. I have one other cool thing I want to show you, but let's run it as it is first. So here you go. We have our randomly generated map. I can hit R and we'll generate a new one. We can change what this would look like a lot by messing with these parameters. So here, for example, I've set it to have a much higher spawn chance and a higher destroy limit. And you can see that we get more fill than space with bigger gaps. And I can regenerate a couple different maps and you can see how it's changing. So there you go, we have our map. We can hit R to reset and generate a new one, and we can get different results by changing the values that we give here. Refresher Tiles code, by the way, has some really helpful sliders that allow you to generate the values directly in game. I decided not to include them here to keep the video shorter, but they're a really nice feature if you want to experiment with different variations, which is another reason to get his code. But now onto something that I think is really helpful. I'm going to comment this line of code out. So now when we create our map, all we're going to do is spawn the initial position. But if we come over here, I have it set up so that whenever we push space, we iterate the map once. So we do one generation and we call the spawn squares function again. And remember, this destroys all prior squares. So basically it will refresh what it looks like on our screen. Now we can iterate through the map and watch the generations as they occur. So you can see that this is what the map starts like, but as we go through generations, empty spaces start to form and they grow bigger over time with this particular set of rules. In fact, if we progressed far enough, you can see that we start to get some pretty big caverns. And doing this is a really good way to get a more instinctual feel for how this algorithm actually works, what it's doing when it's running those iterations. And that's the simulation. Again, this is really basic. There's so much more you can do with this. And in fact, let me know in the comments below if you're interested in seeing some more advanced map generations using cellular automata. But there you go. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you want to learn more about loops or structs, check out the videos down below. And don't forget to check out Refresher Tiles written tutorials as well.